Thank you for the nice presentation. Let me say that it is a great pleasure to be with you in this meeting. And also I would like to thank Dr. Habermann, who elegantly covered the huge problem of pulmonary hypertension in BPD patients. As described, I'm from the University of Padova, and I'm proud to announce that next year we will celebrate 800 years anniversary. Prematurity is a major problem in the developed countries. As you know, one baby in 10 is born premature. But the most problematic premature babies are those called very low birth weight infants, that mean less than 32 weeks of gestational age and less than 100-500 grams. More or less, they are 1-2% of newborns. As we have already seen from Dr. Habermann, Norton and William described the bronchopulmonary dysplasia in 1977, and several definitions of BPD have been proposed. One of the most famous is the one from Alan Job and Eduardo Bancalari, published in 2001, with the definition of 28 days of supplemental oxygen, and the severity was proposed to be classified at 36 weeks. Recently, it has been proposed to use the need of positive pressure instead of supplemental oxygen. But let me say that, in my opinion, the first definition proposed by Alan Job and Eduardo Bancalaris is today one of the best definitions. Here you can see, most of you are pulmonologists, pediatric pulmonologists, so you know very well this model of the changes of lung function across the life. As you know, we reach the maximum at 25 years, more or less. I'm speaking about lung function, probably FEV1. Then there is a small decline without to reach the threshold of symptom and disability. Today, as a pediatrician, we know very well that there are some early insults that can cause an abnormal trajectory. And these early insults are lung immaturity and also early infection. I'm speaking about RSV infection in the first months of life. And it is clear that the people who enter adult life with lower lung function are at increased risk of chronic respiratory diseases later in life. I mean asthma and probably COPD. Here is the scenario of the stages of lung function, of lung development. As you know, today preterm babies born when the lung is still in between the saccular and the canalicular stage. So there is an arrested alveolar and vascular development as presented by Dr. Habermann. In this stage, the lung is not prepared for gas exchanges. And Alan Job proposed this title in a paper, The Survival Miracle of Very Low Birth Weight Infants. Unfortunately, about 45% of preterm infants born less than 28 weeks of gestational age develop bronchopulmonary dysplasia. And despite the tremendous advance in obstetric, I mean antenatal maternal steroid and neonatal care, surfactant, gentle ventilation, BPD remain a major cause of morbidity and mortality among premature infants. Here you can see all the strategies that have been used or are used for the acute phase of RDS, but also to prevent bronchopulmonary dysplasia, where over the past 25 years, no safe therapy had a substantial impact on the incidence and the severity of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So now I will share with you some data about the clinical and functional respiratory outcome of BPD survivors from infancy to adulthood. Of course, the first years, the first 2-3 years are very difficult for BPD survivors. They can have oxygen dependency. RSV bronchiolitis is a huge problem for this infant. They have hospitalization for infection or for recurrent wheezing. They use asthma medication, even if they are not asthmatics. They can have impaired exercise capacity. About oxygen dependency, unfortunately, the start of home oxygen therapy has improved the quality of life of these children and their families. About RSV, as you can know, we can use palivizumab, and the American Academy of Pediatrics recommend the palivizumab for BPD infants. This is a picture of the exit of our neonatal intensive care unit in Padova. These are two twins, 23 weeks, discharged after 4 months, both with the diagnosis of BPD. One, as you can see, is still oxygen dependent. What is the future of these babies? What about lung function with age? Obviously, we should be able to measure lung function when they are neonates, infant, preschool children, but it is not easy to do it. And a couple of years ago, when Galileo Galilei was in Padova, he wrote this sentence: measure what is measurable and make measurable what is not. We have several tests of lung function, the tidal breathing, the occlusion technique for neonates and infants, and for preschool children, the interrupter technique, the forced oscillation technique, and when they are school age, we can measure spirometry. But unfortunately, the missing link is the possibility to measure lung function in the routine in infants and preschool children. When they are school age, we can perform a spirometry, and FV1 is, as you know, is the most robust parameter of flow imitation, but we know that today FEV1 is also a powerful predictor of increased risk of early cardiopulmonary mortality. This is a study we published in the New England several years ago. At that time, we collected all the studies available on the measurement of lung function in BPD survivors. And as you can see in red, all these studies demonstrated a marked reduction in FEV1 at different ages, 7, 9, 10, 18, 20 years of age. So with this data, we sensitized the medical community about this new chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Later, Dr. Koteka from UK performed a meta-analysis about the data on FEV1 in BPD survivors, and they confirm this data demonstrating a marked reduction in FEV1. But what is important of this paper is that they demonstrated that also preterm non-BPD patients present a reduction in airway function. And this is a very important paper because they collected data from 24 bird cohort. They measure lung function and they found a very important point, that is that children with young gestational age have a lower FEV1 independently from the development of BPD. So also preterm babies without a diagnosis of BPD will have a reduction in FEV1. But what about longitudinal lung function studies? This is one of the best studies evaluating longitudinal lung function studies in preterm babies. Is from Australia. A large number of preterm children, less than 32 weeks of gestation, they measure lung function at 4 or 5 years of age, and then at 12 years. And here you can see the results, a marked reduction in FEV1 BPD patient, but a big concern about the decline they found between 4 and 12 years of age, but also preterm non-BPD patient presented a reduction in lung function. But we had also a longitudinal study in Padova. We started the studies in 1991 and we are still following this patient. This is a small study, moderate to severe BPD, but this is unique because we measure lung function at birth in the first months of life. We use the squeezing technique at 2 years of age, and then when they we reach the school age, we measure lung function at 8, 15, 20, and 24 years of age. Here you can see the results that are not good because we found a significant flow limitation until 24 years of age. 65% had a FEV1 less than 80% and no catch up with age in airway function. What is interesting is that we found a good correlation between FEV1 at 20 years of life and VUMAX FRC at 2 years of age. So we can identify and treat those young children at a great risk of developing a chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. What is interesting is that when we evaluated the quality of life in adolescent survivors of BPD, we found a dissociation between lung function and quality of life. We included in the studies a BPD patient at the age of 11, 19 years, and also a group of asthmatic patients with the same lung function. As you can see, BPD patient presented a good quality of life similar to that of healthy children. But today, one of the main unsolved questions about BBD survivors when they are school age is which Lyme disease do they have? Asthma, a new COPD-like phenotype, another Lyme disease. Here you can see the CT imaging in patient with BPD at the age of 1 year, 16 years, 21 years. This is a systematic review from this group in the Netherlands, and they concluded that this patient at different ages present emphysema, fibrosis, bronchial wall thickening, and an important architectural distortion of the lung. This is the real life. You have a child, 8 years old. He presents asthma-like symptoms. He's a preterm baby with a diagnosis of BPD, spirometric evidence of flow limitation. Well, this patient around the world are frequently treated with inhaled corticosteroid, but there is no evidence to support this practice. The lack of lung pathology data in school age and adolescent BPD survivors make the pathogenesis elusive and the treatment empirical. A couple of years ago, we decided to evaluate in a non-invasive way if BPD patient present airway inflammation, and we measure exhaled nitroxide. As you know, exhaled nitroxide is a good marker of TH, eosinophilic airway inflammation, and is a marker of steroid sensitivity. Here you can see the result, very high values in asthmatic patient. Here you can see healthy people, and here BPD patient who presented normal to reduced values of exhaled nitroxide. The studies suggest that they do not have an airway inflammation similar to that of asthmatic patient, and probably they are not steroid sensitive. Recently, we, together with Dr. Rabma, we published this paper in three patients with three adolescent BPD survivors with a very low values of FEV1. We performed bronchial biopsies, and again, we found absence of T helper lymphocyte and the eosinophils. So no type 2 airway inflammation. So a direct confirmation that they are different from asthmatics. So we believe that the term asthma should be avoided in describing the chronic lung disease in survivors of BPD and preterm birth. And on our opinion, there is concern that BPD and preterm birth survivors may be at risk of developing a new COPD-like phenotype in adult life. What about the treatment of these children when they are school age, when they are adolescent, or when they are young adults? Unfortunately, and I can understand that you will be disappointed about this, very few studies are available about the treatment of these children. 2 years ago, together with a group of researcher, doctor on the field of bronchopulmonary dysplasia from Europe, USA, and Australia, we published this guideline on the long-term management of children with BPD, evaluating studies on children discharged from the hospital or with more than 36 weeks of postmenstrual age. And here I summarize the result, and all the results are of low evidence because no studies are available. For those who need supplemental oxygen, the target range advice is 90-95. 93-95 is probably the best target. What about bronchodilators like salbutamol? We concluded that bronchodilators can be used only if asthma-like symptom and or reversibility in lung function. What about to treat this patient with inhaled steroids? Our conclusion is that inhaled steroids are not recommended. We left open a window and the possibility to consider inhaled corticosteroid as a trial in patients with severe disease. What about diuretics? Not suggested unless signs of fluid retention. And what about the daycare attendance? No studies at all about this topic. So our conclusion is to give an individual advice. Most of the authors of this guideline suggested to avoid daycare attendance in the first winter after birth. No studies are available on therapies used for patients with asthma and COPD. I mean the association between inhaled corticosteroid and long-acting beta-2 agonist. I mean long-acting muscarinic antagonist. I mean in the association with the LAMA, LABA, and ICS combination. No studies in DPD survivors with these drugs. The Canadian Society of Pediatrics published this recommendation about the follow-up of BPD patients and preterm babies less than 28 weeks of gestational age. As you can see, they recommend a very long follow-up arriving to adolescents, evaluating symptoms at discharge, in infancy, 3, 6, 8 years. They also suggested to perform infant lung function when possibly and to perform spirometry starting from the age of 5, 6 years. They also suggest to perform CT scan in those with a severe disease. And as mentioned from Dr. Abman, they suggest to perform an echocardiogram before an ICU discharge, and then they suggest to repeat echocardiography in the first years of life. This is a paper from Dr. Abman suggesting that early pulmonary vascular disease may contribute to the pathobiology of BPD. But is BPD only a lung disease? Absolutely not. As you know, BPD patient, but also preterm, severe preterm, non-BPD patient present several problems, growth failure, pulmonary hypertension, reflux, gastroesophageal reflux, neurodevelopmental sequelae, hearing defect, retinopathy of prematurity. So BPD is a multi-system disease that need a multidisciplinary follow-up. So it is important to set up a multidisciplinary outpatient clinic for children with preterm birth DPD, involving pediatric pulmonologists, neonatologists, pediatric cardiologists, ear, nose, throat physician, physiotherapist, psychologist, and a case manager for this patient. And about heart disease. This is a pretty recent study from Sweden. This is a national cohort study. And they found that preterm birth is associated with a 53% increase relative risk of ischemic heart disease at the age of 30-43 years. And this is to confirm the importance of the vascular abnormalities in this patient that can cause ischemic heart disease when they are young adult. So do they born with the broken heart? This is a new possibility we have to consider when we are dealing with these patients. And again, from Sweden, another national survey. And in this survey, they found that the gestational age is inversely associated with the mortality with a five-fold increased risk for respiratory and cardiovascular disease and diabetes and cause of mortality. So this author suggests, and I fully agree, that preterm birth should be recognized as a chronic condition that requires long-term follow-up. And just to stay update on what is happening with the COVID pandemic, this is a study from Spain, and they clearly demonstrated as low birth weight increases the risk of severe COVID-19 in adults at the age of 40-50 years. So at this point, I think you can agree with me that BPD is the earliest and perhaps the longest lasting obstructive lung disease in humans. So what can we do? There is a great hope about the potentials of stem cell-based therapies in neonatology. As you know, stem cell can be useful for the lung, for the brain, for the gut, for the heart. And we have a lot of studies in animals demonstrating that stem cells are useful, but we have also three studies in humans, three phase one studies demonstrating the safety and in some cases also the efficacy on stem cells. But the new about stem cells is that recently it has been demonstrated that the dominant mode of action of mesenchymal stem cells is by paracrine effects. This means that the effects of mesenchymal stem cells are mediated by extracellular vesicles, opening the way for a cell-free approach. In Padova, we have a model of bronchopulmonary dysplasia, and we have used extracellular vesicle with intratracheal administrations. And the results about alveolization are very good. What is very interesting is that also the result about pulmonary vessels with the reduction of the thickness of small pulmonary vessels is very interesting. So there is also a study in humans with extracellular vesicle that is underway in the United States. So in conclusion, what can I say? That several BPD patients and premature children have substantial obstructive lung disease into childhood that increases the risk of a new COPD-like phenotype in adult life. We believe that the term asthma should be avoided for BPD survivors. We need data on lung pathology of this patient when they are school age or adolescents. Emerging therapies such as stem cell-based therapies hold promise as a next-generation approach to prevent BPD in at-risk preterm infants. Thank you very much for your attention.